Before I introduce our speakers, on behalf of the trustees, I want to thank Dean and Hamilton, Dean and Hamilton Realtors, and the Crook Estate for their sponsorship of Sunday Offer Talks, and also Bruce Sinclair, owner of A Taste for Wine and Spirits, for his contribution of wines to all of our post-talk events. Our speaker today is Molly Burnham. Come on in. Our speaker today is Molly Birnbaum, and following her talk, you're all invited to stay for wine and madeleines. Her book, A Season to Taste, will be available here for purchase and for signing. Although A Season to Taste is Molly's first book, her work also appears in the New York Times, Art News Magazine, and USA Today, among several other publications. Molly was awarded the Pulitzer Prize Travel Fellowship for Arts and Culture from the Columbia Graduate School of Journalism. Her book, A Season to Taste, was named a must-read for the 2012 Massachusetts Book Awards. And she was a finalist in the International Association of Culinary Professionals Cookbook Awards for Literary Writing. Currently, Molly is Associate Editor at America's Test Kitchen and project editor of the 2012 Cook's Illustrated Science of Good Cooking. And I hope, if you haven't done so, that you get a chance to visit her blog called My Madeleines. It's just perfectly wonderful, and I promise you, you will enjoy it. We're grateful that Molly has taken the time to be with us today, so please welcome her with me. If you're, we send emails every month reminding you about the upcoming Sunday Offer Talks. If you would like to be on our email list and you aren't, please sign this. And if we'll pass it down here and then it can just go around and back to the back of the room. Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. It's wonderful to be here. Thank you so much for having me.
I don't think your mic is on.
Is my mic, can you hear me? It sounds like it's on to me.
Okay,
is this better?
Yes.
Okay. Hi. It's great to be here. I grew up in Boston. I haven't spent a lot of time in Cohasset, but it feels very familiar. I'm driving around today. It's beautiful here. And I love libraries. I think libraries is the best place to talk about smells because there's so many wonderful smells with books. I love the smell of books, of old books, books that have been through so many different people. So it's a very fitting place to talk about Season to Taste. So like I said, I grew up in Boston, in Acton actually, way outside of Boston. And I didn't fall in love with food and cooking until I went to college. When I was an undergraduate student at Brown, I was studying art history, but I was obsessed with cooking. I didn't spend time in libraries there, really. I spent time in my kitchen cooking for friends. I read cookbooks rather than textbooks. That was what I loved. And I knew when I graduated that I wanted to be a chef. That was the place that I wanted to go. That was who I wanted to be. And I decided to pursue that immediately. And so right after I graduated, I marched into the kitchen of this restaurant in Boston. The chef, whose name is Tony Maz, had opened it pretty recently. It was called Craigie Street Bistro. It's now Craigie on Main. If anyone's in Cambridge, it's a fantastic restaurant. But I marched into his kitchen, and I think I was wearing high heels and like a button-down shirt, and I printed my resume on really nice paper, and I said, I want a job. I had no experience in the food world whatsoever. I had never really worked in a professional kitchen. And he just raised his eyebrows at me. He said, are you serious? Do you know what you're getting into? And I said, yeah, I'm serious. I want to be a chef. I'll do anything. And he said, okay, you can start tomorrow as my dishwasher. So I did. And that's where I'm going to start doing a little reading for my book from the beginning there. On my first day of work, I paused inside the walk-in refrigerator. The heavy metal door thumped shut behind me, and I inhaled the sharp scents of garlic and onions, vinegar and salt, fillets of tuna and grouper. A lamb carcass hung from the ceiling, sinuous and pink. A vat of chicken stock cooled on the floor. Four bins of fresh specialty herbs were perched on a corner shelf waiting to be plucked, their exotic labels lemon thyme, anise hyssop, Moroccan mint, reminding me how far I stood from my mother's suburban garden. I longed to touch the produce. It had only been 2 weeks since I donned a cap and gown to receive my undergraduate degree. At the restaurant, wearing the uniform white buttoned shirt and a bandana tied tightly around my curly hair, I was surprised to find myself in a world that didn't involve laptops or cell phones, one where I couldn't sleep when I liked or lose myself in the silent recesses of the library hour after hour. It didn't involve much thought or speech, only movement and speed. It was a world filled with boxes of foraged forest mushrooms, stacks of chocolate bars from Venezuela, and plates of quail so carefully assembled that they arrived in the dining room looking like works of art. There were knives so sharp I didn't feel the slice on my finger until blood began to run down my hand. There were saute pans so old that they no longer dented when the volatile head chef slammed them against the counter. There were 11-hour shifts and sweat soaking every inch of cloth on my body. I started with the herbs. The restaurant had dozens of organic herbs delivered to the kitchen each morning. There were familiar ones like basil, rosemary, and thyme, and then there were the exotic ones, ranging from pineapple mint to Syrian oregano. They were delivered from a local specialty farm, tied in tidy muddles and labeled by hand. It was my job to clean and pluck the jumble of leaves and stems and have them ready for dinner service. I bent over the tiny metal table in the back corner of my workspace, a crowded hallway in the shadows of the staircase, and pinched my thumb and index fingers over the rough branches to release as many leaves as possible. Each herb left its scent printed on the tips of my fingers. There was the calm, woodsy odor of rosemary and the cool tang to mint. They blended into a mash of forest green that reminded me of trips to the plant nursery with my father when I was young. "The most important thing, Molly," Moz, the chef, repeated constantly, "is that you know the ingredients. If I hold up this chicory flower, you need to identify it in one glance. If I blindfold you, you need to know it as soon as it hits your tongue." I painstakingly cleaned and tasted the herbs whenever I wasn't swamped at the sink with piles of dirty dishes. I tested myself constantly. I discovered that breathing through my nose, slowly and conscientiously, was the best way to understand the intricacies of such subtle flavor, which, Moz insisted, was the only way to become a chef. One night in the small kitchen, I watched from my perch at the sink as Moz prepared to butcher a 30-pound fillet of tuna in the back hall. He held a long, glistening knife, grasping it tightly by the handle with the sharp edge horizontal to the ground. He brought the blade sideways to his face and pressed his nose against the metal, sliding the knife slowly, painstakingly lengthwise. His nostrils flared with each breath. "He even smells his tools," I thought. "It's how he understands." I didn't spend my time with many knives at the restaurant. Instead, I was at the sink, spraying grimy saute pans with a water nozzle. I constantly scurried to and from the bin where the servers wearing immaculate black aprons tied around their waists dumped the dirty dishes, lugging large stacks of plates to the electric sanitizer in the kitchen. I strained chicken stock and pulled delicate skeletons out of hundreds of fresh, glassy-eyed sardines. I stuck my hands into countless buckets of water and wild mushrooms, black trumpets, hen of the woods, morels, to clean the slippery clouds of fungi. I sorted bunches of bright green arugula for the garde-manger, the line cook whose job was to make cold appetizers and dessert, and delivered them to a station which always smelled of burnt sugar from the torched tops of his creme brulees. It wasn't easy. My arms shook with the strain of unaccustomed weight. My legs bore welts from the hot sprays of oil, and my neck was constantly swathed in a thick layer of slime, the liquid detritus that clung to my body from the sink, from the fridge, from the late-night cleaning of the deep fryer. Moz expected perfection, and I was terrified of making mistakes. He exacted the best, though, and I spent my every moment in the kitchen watching. He moved with confidence and economy, butchered meat with swift, clean swipes of his knife, and could sear perfect fillets of fish using only the sound of its sizzle to gauge its progress. His flavors were bold, his concentration intense, and critics sang his praises. I learned to listen to the sound of meat in the pan, to smell the end notes of the nuts toasting in the oven. I learned to judge by color and texture, to leave the safety of published recipes and instead operate with the senses alone. Moz could be tough, but he never failed to inspire. With his pleasure, the kitchen blazed, the fresh rolls perfuming the hallway with butter and yeast. I tackled herbs and garlic, lamb's tongue, and rich logs of pate. I peeled beets and shallots, chopped onions, and turned bundles of arugula around the barrel-sized spinner again and again until they were clean and dry. I was learning the basics one by one. That was the only way to become a chef. And now I'm going to skip ahead a little bit. I stepped out onto the front porch of my mother's home in Boston in running shoes and shorts on a drizzly morning at the end of August and paused to look at the post-dawn sky. It was dark and cloudy. I could feel the impending rain in the thick air. I'll make this quick, I thought, sticking the headphones of my iPod into my ears. I wanted to spend the rest of the morning reading Harold McGee's On Food and Cooking. My starting date at the Culinary Institute of America was approaching, and I was already nervous. The neighborhood was empty as they began to jog down the street. Even the local high school down the block, in its last week of summer vacation, was quiet. I ran on the sidewalk, bypassing the red pickup truck that was always parked in my way, and sidled up to the corner apartment complex, which bellowed the soapy fresh aroma of laundry from its street-level vents. I loped up a small hill around a wooded corner and then paused at the intersection. Glancing up, I noted the warning of a blinking neon hand signal across the way. I only hesitated for a moment before crossing the four-lane highway. I didn't see the small Ford four-door that sped through the light, which had turned from red to green. I didn't feel the crack of my body against the front bumper. I didn't hear the sound of bone against glass when my skull shattered the windshield. I don't remember flying through the air as I ricocheted off the car and onto the hard sidewalk nearby. For me, the world shot straight to black. I went to my father's house in New Hampshire to recover. It was there that I was able to focus on the world around me. I lay in a bed with a soft green cover. The television mounted on the wall in front of me was large. I watched The Princess Bride one afternoon and didn't fall asleep after 5 minutes. I even remembered it the next day. Things were looking up. But the reality of my situation soon sank in. I was lucky to be alive. I was lucky to have family close by. But with a smashed pelvis and recently sutured leg, I lacked all mobility. I remained completely dependent on my family and friends, and I had never felt so low. I couldn't recognize my own voice, dark with a baritone sadness. I certainly wouldn't allow myself to think about Moz in the kitchen of the Craigie Street Bistro or my impending starting date at the Culinary Institute of America. They were too far from the immediacy of my pain. But I soon realized how much more was gone. My stepmother, Cindy, who was perpetually calm and composed, except for the first time we tried to wrap my bandages in plastic so that I could take a shower, we both ended up in tears, baked an apple crisp one afternoon in October. My best friend was there for the weekend. Becca had come bearing books and CDs, bravely cheerful in the face of my deepening depression. Cindy had baked her apple crisp because she knew I loved the dessert so reminiscent of fall. For over a month, I had had to be coaxed and cajoled into eating, and my stepmother hoped that this would help. When she took the crisp out of the oven, one room over, everyone began to exclaim, "That smell," they said. "It's delicious." I sniffed. "What?" "The crisp," said Becca, pointing toward the kitchen. "What about it?" "Can't you smell it?" she asked. I sniffed again. I must not be in the right seat, I thought. There must be something in my way. I inhaled and exhaled. "The crisp," she pointed. "What?" I asked again, like I couldn't hear her words. For me, there was nothing. Soon, Cindy brought the steaming pan into the family room. She held the fresh-baked apples, ripe with cinnamon and sugar and spice, close to my face. I leaned over and inhaled. I could feel the heat on my chin and in my nose. The air felt different, thick and humid, but there was no scent. "I can't smell," I said it softly. There was silence. I remember the silence. It was white hot and long. No one said a word. "I can't smell a thing." When I took a bite, concentrating intently on the food in my mouth for the first time since before the accident, I mainly registered the texture. I could feel the softness of the baked fruit and the crunch of the crinkly top, but the flavor, it tasted like nothing but a dull sweet, a muted sugar. The cinnamon, the nutmeg, the lemon had vanished. The honey was unattainable and the oats gone. Where was the rich cream of the butter? I can't taste, I said. Later that night, Becca and I sat among pillows and blankets on my bed, my leg and its brace fanned out in front. What if I never smell again? Is this better? I think this is better. Okay. Keep you in suspense. On that note, I lost my sense of smell in the car accident completely. I would later learn that when I was hit by the car, I smashed the back of my head on the windshield. And on that impact, my brain bounced in my skull, in effect severing the olfactory neurons, which run from the nose to the brain, kind of like a lawnmower over grass. In one split second, they were all torn, and my sense of smell was completely gone. I went to see doctors. I went to see a few doctors, EMTs. I even went to a special taste and smell clinic in Connecticut, and most of the doctors told me that there was very little hope that I would recover. Some people do. They weren't sure why. They weren't sure who. There was absolutely nothing I could do except sit back and wait. And this was especially devastating to me for many of the reasons what I wrote about in the first chapter of my book. Smell is so integral to flavor. It is so important when you eat, when you cook. So immediately what I noticed when I couldn't smell is that I couldn't taste. And I could still taste, technically. I had salty, sweet, bitter, sour, and umami, which are perceived by the taste buds on your tongue. What I lost was all the smell. And smell is 80 to 90% of flavor. So without the smell of food, I could feel it, I could taste if it was salty or sweet, but that was it. All of the nuance, all of the herbs, everything that made food recognizable and good was completely gone. And so I knew that I couldn't cook, because if I didn't know what I was serving, I didn't know what I was making, I couldn't taste it myself, I would have no idea what it would taste like to someone who I was giving it to. I knew that everything had to change. And so I actually have a little experiment that I like to do when I'm doing readings. And I'm gonna pass around this bowl, which is filled with jelly beans. And to demonstrate how important smell is with flavor, what I'm gonna ask you to do, if you want, you definitely don't have to, is when the bowl comes to you, take out a jelly bean, but don't look at the color, because visuals are such a key component in figuring out what something's gonna taste like. So don't look at the color, which will give you a hint at the flavor. Put it in your nose. Maybe put it in your mouth. Put it in your mouth and hold your nose while it's in your mouth and chew and see if you can tell what the flavor of the jelly bean is. Give it a couple of chews. Breathe in and out through your mouth, not your nose. And then let go of your nose and smell as you eat and see how that changes the flavor of the jelly bean. So I'm just going to start this over here and you guys can pass it around. Because it really was surprising to me how important smell was when it came to flavor. Even though I was working in a restaurant, even though I was cooking, even though this was something I was so passionate about, it shocked me how much everything was gone when I couldn't smell. It was like my world had faded from color to black and white. And as time went on, I began to realize that smell had a lot more to do with other things in my life and not just flavor, which is when things began to be a little bit more terrifying to me, because smell is very connected to emotion. It's very connected to memory. I think we've all had the experiences in which we encounter a familiar but unexpected smell, and it takes us straight back to a moment in our past, usually a moment in our childhood, usually a emotional gut-punching type of memory that feels much more visceral and real because of this smell than it does just from remembering that it happened. I often think about salsa when I talk about losing my sense of smell, because when I couldn't smell anything, I ate a lot of really spicy salsa, like really spicy salsa or Tabasco sauce. I would put Tabasco sauce on anything. I would drink Tabasco sauce. I loved it because I could feel it in my mouth. It was a sensation that gave some kind of quality to what I was eating. But so I ate a lot of salsa, and every time I opened a jar of salsa, I would think about the smell memory that I was missing, Because when I was a little girl, on Sunday nights, my father and I would always watch James Bond movies together every single Sunday night, and I was definitely too young to watch them because they terrified me. And I remember I had this crocheted blanket which had holes in it that I would drape over my head so I could see the television, but I still had this like shield. But I loved it. I loved watching these movies with my father. We would always eat chips and salsa while we watched James Bond movies. So the smell of salsa for years afterward would bring me back to the basement in my house, being kind of terrified, but also really happy eating chips and salsa with my father. And of course, when I couldn't smell, that was completely gone. And that, to me, felt devastating, that these pieces of my past were gone. I didn't even know what pieces were gone anymore. Is it working with the jelly beans?
Yeah.
And I wonder what it meant about the person I was going to be in the future if I was no longer capable of making these memories that were so tied to smell. So this was hard. I was recovering for a long time after the accident. I had knee surgery. I smashed my pelvis. It took a while. But when I could walk again, I moved to New York City because I wanted to escape. I didn't want to be in Boston where this restaurant existed, where the career that I thought I was going to have had started. So I moved to New York and I started to write. But during this time, I started to get really angry that there were no answers to my questions about smell. And smell is the most mysterious of all the senses. There's still so much that we don't know about how it works, why it doesn't work sometimes, and why was there no cure for this loss of smell, which is much more common than most people realize. There are more than 3 million people in the United States alone that can't smell. You can lose your sense of smell from an accident like mine, a head injury. You can lose your sense of smell just from getting a virus. A simple winter cold can knock it out. And there are so many people who have had this happen to them. And I started to meet a lot of them when I was living in New York. Age is another reason you lose your sense of smell. And there are a whole lot of other things in the mix. It's very common. But people don't talk about it, I think, in part because smell is such an invisible sense, and it's one that doesn't really come with readily available words. And most people, when they ask what sense they would like to lose, if they had to lose one, they say smell because you don't really need it. But you do. It's just much more quiet and, I think, powerful in the long run. So I began to talk to people, chefs, perfumers, flavorists, lots of scientists, trying to figure out answers. Like, why did this happen to me? How could I recover? What had happened? What does it mean? Why was I so devastated that I couldn't smell a thing? And I got some answers, but there were a lot of holes left for more, which is when I started to write about my experience without a sense of smell, which eventually turned into my book. But I was different in my experience than a lot of other people. I was very, very lucky, because all the while, my sense of smell slowly began to return. It was one smell at a time over the course of many years. It was a really wild experience because these smells would come back one at a time, kind of like a street lamp turning on in the pitch black, just like boom, there it was. And it wouldn't come back with any others. They were singular and they were alone, and I could smell it. I couldn't smell anything else. And it really taught me a lot about what to look for, what to pay attention to. Cucumber was one of the first smells that came back, and I had never thought that cucumber had a smell, but it is a fantastic smell, especially when it's not anything can smell. But I found it a fascinating experience as well because good smells came back first for me. They were smells that meant things to me. I don't really know what cucumber meant, but like chocolate came back in the beginning, and I could smell the fruity grape of wine in the beginning. Laundry detergent, which I think is just such a home smell, a comfort smell, that came back first. It was a year before I smelled anything bad, which was actually kind of great too, because I was in New York and it was summer, which is when all the smells come out. And I was working at an art magazine in Midtown, and I remember I walked out to get coffee one day, and I was walking down the block toward the coffee house I went to pretty much every day, and just minding my own business, and all of a sudden I stopped. I could smell something, and it was really different than anything I had smelled in a long time. And I stopped, and I turned, and I looked, and there was just this pile of trash bags on the side of the road, like, sitting there in the heat, like, rotting, stinking, trash day trash bags. And I just stood there and like breathed in that smell for a while. Loved it. Part of my recovery was a little weird. I mean, weirder than liking the smell of rotting trash. It's very common for people who have lost their sense of smell to experience something called a phantom smell, which is similar to when someone loses a limb and still can feel that limb there, like it's actually present. I smelled things that didn't exist. For me, I was positive that I could smell my own brain for a while, because I was smelling the smell all the time. And it was kind of an earthy smell. It was a good smell. I think I described it as a garden without the flowers, but it was in my bedroom, it was in the kitchen, it was in the car, it was outside, it was everywhere. And I had no idea where this could be coming from, so I thought it must be coming from inside my head and the direction of my nose and breathing. It seemed likely that it was my brain. It wasn't. A lot of people smell things that aren't there. The neurons are misfiring and there's miswiring and just confused signals, which I thought was pretty interesting. But a lot of people experience horrible smells, like rotting flesh is very common for people who are experiencing phantom smells, which is devastating to experience on a daily basis. I had to kind of relearn smells as I was getting my sense of smell back. Things weren't familiar to me anymore. I didn't have the words for smells as they came back. And a couple things changed a little bit. Like one afternoon, I was driving with my mother on Martha's Vineyard. We went for a girls' weekend, and it was summer again when all the smells come out, and we had the windows open, and we were driving, and there was a smell, and yes, there is a smell. I can smell it. This is fantastic. It smells so good. My mom asked me, you know, what does it smell like to you? And I was like, oh, it's like a bakery, cookies. It's like almond biscotti. She looked at me, that's crazy. And she said, Ma, that is skunk. I love the smell of skunk now. I don't know what that means. But I think I'll close, and then I'd love to take questions if you guys have any. One of the questions I get most often since my book was published a year and a half ago is, you know, what is your favorite smell now that you can smell again? And I think, without a doubt, my favorite smell is the fresh herb rosemary, because that was the very first scent that returned to me. And it wasn't a crazy long time after the accident. I was still living in Boston. I was helping my mother to cook dinner because I couldn't leave the kitchen even though I couldn't smell. And I might have even still been on crutches. But I had this sprig of fresh rosemary, and I had pulled off all the leaves like I did when I was working at the restaurant, and I was chopping them up. I was alone in the kitchen, and then all of a sudden this smell hit me, and it was earthy and woodsy and deep dark green, and it reminded me of a moment when I was a kid and we had gone horseback riding out west for the first time, and there must have been rosemary bushes, and that memory just hit me out of nowhere. It was really quite wonderful. Anyway, so I'd like to close and take questions now.
Yes. When, for instance, the rosemary came back and all the different smells, did they smell the same to you as before? Were they very familiar, so there wasn't any change in them?
That's a good question. Were the smells that came back familiar? Did they smell like they used to smell to me? Most of them, yes. Rosemary smelled like rosemary to me. Skunk was different, but most things smelled like I remember them. But by the time my sense of smell came back completely in a way that I trusted it, in a way that I felt like I could smell everything around me, it was more than 5 years after the accident. It took a very long time. And so as a result, I don't really remember what things smelled like before, because I never really thought about it too much. So I'm pretty positive that everything smells like it did, at least most of the way. I'm sure there are some tiny changes here and there, ones that I'll probably never know. I did have to relearn a lot of the words associated with smells when they came back. If I was not looking at what was smelling like something, I could not identify it. I had to reteach myself. I even went to perfume school in France for 2 weeks for like this boot camp, smelling raw chemicals all day for 8 hours to try and retrain my nose to remember things, to memorize things, to have words come to mind when I smelled something. And it took a lot of work, and I still have trouble with it now. And no one can really tell me why.
first of all, I've read the book, and it was absolutely wonderful.
Thank you.
And I admire your tenacity in all the places you went, including Bross, which was awesome. But my query, you said it was probably about 5 years from your accident until you feel quite recovered. There was a part in the book where you mentioned people with the same disability, sometimes permanent, sometimes not, who had fears for their safety because they couldn't smell smoke, they couldn't smell gas if there were a gas leak. Did you personally have concerns, or did you find yourself relying on people making sure? I would think that would be, you'd be fraught with anxiety.
Yeah, no, that is an excellent point, and definitely something I felt. Without a sense of smell, you really lose cues for all sorts of danger, like smoke, like gas leaks, like rotting food. It's impossible to tell, because most people know that by smelling it. So I was very nervous about that, and I made this declaration when I couldn't smell that I would never live alone if I couldn't smell, because it just felt very dangerous to me. So I always lived with roommates when I was living with my family until much later, and I felt confident in my training sense of smell. But this is something that's huge for people who can't smell, the sense of safety. And I know a lot of people who are very, very worried about it. And when they can't smell. And I mean, even just small everyday things, like, are my clothes clean? Like, do I smell all right? It's hard to not know that. So you just have to ask people that are close to you.
Do you think you worked really hard to get this sense of smell back? I remember you went even to the flavor lab and to another perfume school here in the United States. Do you think if you hadn't done all of these things, if you had just sat back and done nothing, that it still would have returned?
If I had sat back and done nothing, would it still have returned?
I mean, at one point you were even putting herbs in your nose, like just.
Yeah, smelling. Yeah, I mean, it's hard to know. I think that because I was so young, I was 22 when I was hit by the car, that put a lot of the recovery, like that made my recovery more easy, I think, or the possibility of recovery was easier because I was so young. And I think that smells would have come back no matter what, because they did in the beginning just come unbeknownst. It was only later in the recovery process that I really began to work at it. And that had more for me to do with recognizing smells. And figuring out nuance of smell and trying to understand different smells on their different layers so that when I did re-enter the kitchen, I could do it and I could do it well. So I think that my sense of smell would have returned at least most of what it has. I think the training did help bring some smells back, but I think I would be much worse at smelling today if I had not done all of that work.
And naming the smells.
Because I had always assumed that perfumers, for example, were born with an amazing nose and they could just do it. They had this amazing ability that they were born with. Not true. Perfumers train for so many years to understand every single aspect of every single fragrance out there. And it's again and again and again, smelling and re-smelling and memorizing and re-memorizing. So they know it so well, it's like intuitive. And they can imagine smells. And they can imagine like a symphony of smells coming together, which is what a perfume is in the end. And so I took a lot of cues from that. I mean, if I wanted to smell good, not I mean if I wanted to smell things well, I would have to work at it. So I did, and that I think that made it easier for me in the end. Yes, in the back.
I'm interested to know how did you find the medical care that you received? I mean, it kind of sounds like you just, you know, they were like, well, you might get it back or not. Were you, or did you find the medical providers that you had to be helpful and informative and detailed, or were they just kind of crossing their fingers?
The medical providers that I had were not that helpful. I had doctors tell me that it was over, I would never smell again. I had doctors test me for days on end and say, there's nothing we can do, good luck. So, I mean, I got some information from them. I think everyone was doing the best that they could with the information at hand. There really just isn't a lot of information out there about losing your sense of smell and possibility of recovering. But I think it's common for people who lose their sense of smell, who go to doctors, who go to taste and smell centers, and there are a handful of them in the United States, to feel very frustrated with the medical care, simply because there are no solutions and there really aren't many answers except to go deeper into why it happened to you. For one part of my book, I spent a lot of time in the waiting room of a taste and smell center at the University of Pennsylvania. And it's a very small little center with one doctor who tests people who have lost their sense of smell and taste. And you go in for one day, 8-hour day, battery of tests to find out how much you can smell, how much you can't smell, what you can taste, what you can't taste. They test your jaw and your nose and your tongue and your mouth. They test everything just to find out exactly what's working and what isn't working. And I met so many people there who couldn't smell and who were just incredibly frustrated with the whole experience because there just simply were not any answers. So one of the things I've been doing since writing the book is working with doctors to make support groups for people who can't smell. Just, it helps to talk to other people who are going through the same thing. And that was one of the great things about the waiting room of this Taste and Smell Center, because it was the only place I'd ever been, I think most anyone had ever been, in which there were a number of people there together all day who knew exactly what you were going through. Yeah.
Did your body try to compensate for your loss of smell and taste by, was your sight a little more acute? I mean, did you look at, say, a piece of meat to make sure it wasn't rotten? Could you see things or could you hear things that you weren't aware of before?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, a lot of people, people who lose eyesight or hearing, they feel their other senses are more acute. I don't think that's the case with me. I don't think my other senses became more, had better ability, became more acute. But one thing that did change is I paid a lot more attention to them, and I spent a lot more time thinking about the sight of something or the sound of something. I taught myself to cook with my other senses, which is something I did a lot, and that really showed me the value of sound, of sight, of, you know, touch, like touching food as you cook it. So in that way, yes, but it's only because I made it, so.
So if you were to organize a seminar on wine tasting, would you actually put more emphasis on the smells? I mean, would you, do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, 100%. I mean, I think almost a large chunk of wine tasting is smell and the nuance of smell. And I think it's the most important part.
I just started your book and maybe you explain it, but what's the association with Madeleine? Is there a connection with Proust?
Yeah, one of the most iconic scenes with smell and memory is in Proust's Remembrance of Things Past. And it's in the very beginning of the book when the narrator takes a bite of a Madeleine cookie in lime flower tea, and he remembers he's brought right back to his childhood. He was in Combray, I think, and his aunt fed him crumbles of Madeleine and lime flower tea. And it's a really beautifully written passage by Proust, and it is one of the things that everyone talks about when you're talking about smell memory. It's one of the first times, one of the most beautiful times someone wrote about it in this way. And I mean, it's actually kind of strange because I write a blog, it's called My Madeleine. I started it before I lost my sense of smell. I started it before I thought about smell memory. Because the way I like to write about food is with its connection to past and to people and culture and everything that surrounds food. So it felt fitting to me then, but it's even more fitting to me now. But yeah, that is the connection. Yes?
Can doctors quantify your regrowth or regeneration, I'm not sure what you call it. Like, are you positive that it's 100% back, or are you just relying on your past experience?
I am not positive that it's 100% back. I wasn't tested before I lost my sense of smell, and I've tested myself again now in the way that many of the taste and smell centers do, but that's a scratch and sniff test in which you identify smells on a page. And when I did that, I scored very poorly. This was a number of years ago. It was before I really felt completely comfortable, but I scored very, very poorly on that test, and it really freaked me out. I wrote about it a bit in the book, and that was when I realized that I could smell, but I couldn't identify smells, and that's why that was such a problem for me. So I don't really know that there is a test that will actually tell me how much I can smell now versus then, because it's all tied to identifying smells accurately, which I think is a very different thing too. So that's a long answer to say no, I'm not sure that I feel like I can.
I thought your book was extremely well written, and there's just a certain passage that I love where you put the word redolent alongside the word sounds, which you usually think of redolent with scents, and I love that. And I just wonder, just listening to you now, how long after you started to recover your sense of smell did you actually start putting your thoughts to the page? Because your imagery is superlative, and I just wondered now, when you couldn't recall what things really smelled like or tasted like, how were you then able to put that down on paper?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, On one level, I am a prolific journaler, and I write every day, and I have, since I could write, I have journals from when I was in elementary school talking about my crushes on boys, and it got a little more complicated as time went on. But so I wrote a lot throughout my entire experience just for myself, which was very helpful when I went back to write the book. And what was the other part of your question? I just totally lost my train of thought.
How long was it once, did you have to wait until you regained your sense of smell to be able to recollect and put those images down on paper?
No, I did not. I thought so much about smell when I couldn't smell and what it used to smell like. I think that's one of the reasons why I became so good at describing smell. Even though I couldn't smell it, I thought about it and I tried to remember it, and I tried to write down everything that I could remember about it, and I really tried to recreate it for myself in words because I wasn't getting it in the real world. So it took a lot of practice, and there I had to cut a lot of adjectives here and there, but I mean, I missed it so much, and I love to write about things that I miss, so.
Forgive me, because I only got to the point where you smell the skunk. Well, you didn't smell the skunk, but your mom told you the skunk today, and the book is absolutely beautifully written. So my question is, what are you doing today, and do you have plans for continuing to, you know, your cooking profession, but also writing?
Well, thank you. Today I work as an editor for a Cooks Illustrated magazine, and I came on to the company about a year and a half ago, actually like a month before my book was published, which was a little silly timing-wise, but I edited The Cooks Illustrated, The Science of Good Cooking, which is a cookbook that was just published in October, and it was a very interesting project because it combines a lot of what I'm very interested in, which is cooking and science and why things work and how things work and really digging into the reasons that, you know, recipes work the way they do, that food cooks the way it does, why things taste in certain ways, how all the senses are combined. So I spent about a year and a half editing this book, and now I work for Cooks Illustrated magazine, which is published every 2 months, and it's stories about recipes. And I love it. It's a really wonderful way of combining everything I like. But that said, I miss writing books too, so I am working on more ideas, different stories to move forward once I finish this stuff up.
I wonder if you could talk about the vocabulary of scents, and when you're rebuilding your database of scents, were you associating scents with words? How were you identifying them? I'm thinking back to my high school chemistry class, where Mr. Kapp took a lighter, he burnt a few hairs on his forearm, went around the classroom, and asked us to identify that smell. And all 35 of us agreed it smelled just like burning chicken feathers. And then Mr. Kapp said, "How many of you ever smelled burning chicken feathers?" Not one of us. So, what did you have? What did you start with when you were at Craigie on Main? how were you building those smells when you lost it? Were you retrieving back notions, words? How were you doing that?
That's a great question. I mean, when I was smelling things at Craigie, I wasn't thinking about it too much. I mean, I was just kind of doing it, and I expected to always be able to do it for the rest of my life. So I wish I had had the forethought to, like, collect things in my brain and really think about it in that way. And then when my sense of smell did start to come back and I started to work on retrieving words, it was really hard. It was really hard. That is one of the reasons why I went to perfume school, because I was struggling so much and I wanted tools to draw words to smells and to remember smells. And what worked for me there was without words at all, pretty much. The way I could remember smells the best was to assign feelings to them and colors and memories, which sounds kind of strange, but we would sit at this long table all day and we'd have all of these smells, some of which were familiar, others which weren't, but didn't really matter. If I close my eyes and smell, we have these little blotters that you stick into a bottle and smell them, and if I close my eyes, something would come to mind when I smelled the smell. It was a very like synesthetic experience. It really was one highly unattached to words for me. And if I could memorize that color, or, you know, there was this one chemical or ingredient called neroli, and every time I closed my eyes, I saw a gray line with little pinpricks of gold on top of it, every single time after the first one. And so I could remember that smell from that image. When I would smell it again, I would see that, and I'd be, oh, neroli, I know it now. And I think because smell and language, the places in our brain that process those two are very far removed, and I don't think they're very connected. And I think it is only frustrating when you have to try and connect them in your brain. So for me, I remember smells a lot more by imagery and emotion.
Had to cook for others after your accident, when you were physically able, did you do so by relying on following recipes?
Yeah, I followed recipes much more closely, whereas before I would kind of, you know, do whatever and throw something in and taste it and see how it went. When I couldn't smell, I used recipes, and I also used my mother when I was at home to taste things as things went along, or my friends later on. My mom told me later that my cooking was erratic at times. So it was hard.
And it's hard to trust, isn't it? Even as it starts to come back, to trust what you're doing and tasting when you start to improvise or be more creative.
Yeah, no, it was hard to trust myself as I recovered. It took me a really long time. I mean, it took me many years, and even today I sometimes still doubt myself. One great thing about working at Cook Illustrated is that part of my job is people are developing recipes. The whole first floor is a kitchen, and there are like 40 test cooks who develop recipes all day, every day in the test kitchen. And part of my job is to taste these recipes when they are done. We have this whole intercom system straight from the kitchen to the phone on the editor's desk, so my phone will just scream out like beef stew tasting and they running down and taste it. But so we taste and we talk about the flavors and the smells, and it's really been a wonderful tool to help me trust my sense of taste and flavor again.
Yes, along the same lines, in your research, what did you know anything about how we all smell differently?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, and something I think about a lot, actually, because I don't believe that any of us are smelling the same things in the same way at all. Because when you think about me, things have changed a little bit from before to now. I smell things differently than before. I think, well, I mean, we have no way to know, really, what rosemary smells like to you or to you. I mean, it could be completely different. And I think most people in the field believe that there is differences from person to person, and that it's almost impossible to know exactly how. But I mean, one interesting example is cilantro, the herb. Some people love it and some people hate it. And they found that there is the gene that people have that kind of dictates whether you will like or hate cilantro. And I talked to one scientist who was really fascinated with this whole thing, and he brought in this reporter who hated cilantro to the sensory science clinic in Philadelphia. And this reporter called cilantro evil, like he hated it so much. It smelled like, so it tasted like soap to him. And they had this machine called a gas chromatograph, which when you put in a smell, it kind of releases each particular part of the smell one at a time, so you can see every single different part of it. And this reporter who hated smell could smell every part of cilantro until it got to the really good one, the one that makes it smell like cilantro. To me, I love cilantro. And the scientist could smell that good part, but this reporter couldn't. So cilantro for him stopped at soapy.
Oh.
He did not have the ability to smell that part. So yes, I think we all smell differently in some ways. Any others? Yes.
Just triggered my my thoughts on the idea of smell of wine. You know, when people describe wine, they'll have like 30 different adjectives for a particular wine. I mean, I know what I like, but I'm smelling the wine, I like it, and I like the taste, and I'm thinking, how do they get, you know, blackberry and citrus, smoking this? I'm thinking, how do they do that? You know, and I don't know if they're faking it sometimes, or it's just a very sophisticated smell that they have, or what, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I think in part that has a lot to do with training and people who are, and I think maybe people who have not trained in wine and can do that are maybe faking it a little bit. But sommeliers, like people who have gone through intense wine training, really do learn the skills to pick out those tiny nuances of scent. It's really amazing what you can do when you work at your nose in that way. So I do think there is total legitimacy to that, if you work at it very hard and train yourself to pick out all those things.
After all this, do you think you'll ever go back to cooking? Toni Maas and...
Oh, that's a good question. I get that question a lot. And, you know, I don't think so. Because along the way for all of this, I love cooking. But I also fell in love with writing.
Mm-hmm.
So I think for me, the ideal career is combining those in some way going forward. And cooking in a restaurant is wonderful, and I love going to restaurants, but it's a very tough,
consuming.
It's a tough industry to be in. It's physically demanding. The hours are hard, and I think it would be easier to start from the bottom there and move up at 22 than 30. So, I don't know. Probably not.
Gentleman on National Public Radio speak about the science of cooking. Sounded fascinating. So now that I know you're connected with that, I can just that. But I don't know if it's a stupid question, but does the sense of smell affect a gag reflex at all? And do you lose
that
reflex?
I think it does, and people feel disgust based on smell, and that can influence that. Yeah, I mean, I don't actually know about.
I was wondering if that was, you know, if that would be a problem, if you lost that.
Well, I mean, it is a problem if you can't smell and you don't know if food is rotting. Like, I know a lot of people who cannot smell who have eaten rotten food and gotten sick, and they did not have that gag reflex, that disgust reflex. They couldn't smell it. But, I mean, I guess they would still have it if there were other cues for something being disgusting. But that is a big problem with not being able to smell.
So maybe if you looked at something and it looked repulsive to you,
yeah.
If you tried to eat it, you might just, even though you don't, you can't smell it, you might still have that
definitely
reaction.
Yeah.
I just want to say thank you for passing around the jelly beans.
You're welcome. Did everyone try that?
The jelly bean tasted sweet, and then I smelled it and I went, I mean, it was huge difference.
Yeah, I mean, without
huge
smell,
difference.
You just have the salty, sweet, bitter, sour your tongue, so you can just taste the sweet on your tongue, and then the flavor comes with the smell.
Very good.
Can I ask a question of the audience, though? And this might just be me, because I have a strange sense of smell anyway. But
when I didn't look at the color, and I held my nose, and I tasted, and I could taste, as you said, just sweet. Had no idea what flavor it was. But when I released my nose, I tasted much more, but I did not really know what flavor it was. And I wonder if it's because I didn't really smell it first before eating it. Did anyone like that?
That also, I will fully admit, I got those jelly beans at Trader Joe's, so they might not be like totally defined, like.
Jelly bellies. Another question back there. Yes. We'll take two more. Yeah.
For someone who's lost the sense of taste with age, is there anything she could do to help herself? You know, with age, I don't think her sense of taste is coming back, and I know it really bothers her. Are there things that she could do differently, or
the sense of taste itself on the tongue?
I believe so.
Yeah. I mean, it's hard, no matter what. There's not much one can do to get it back. One thing that I've done a lot, and a lot of people who have lost smell and taste have done a lot, is to eat, concentrate on the other senses while eating, which is hard to do and sounds kind of lame when you say it out loud. But eating food that's colorful, that's like nicely plated, that looks good, that makes something so much more appetizing to me. I spend a lot of time with different temperatures and different textures in food, which I love and don't need taste or smell to enjoy, like something warm with something cold. I mean, I'm a dessert person, so like a warm brownie with cold ice cream, like that was the epitome of deliciousness when I couldn't smell, because you have both of those temperatures in your mouth. And if you concentrate on making food that has many different textures in it, that's also much more interesting to eat, and I found it much easier to eat when I was concentrating on that as well.
This was such an educational journey, you just kind of fell into it. But then I realized, seeing you today, you were 22 years old and your dream is gone. How did you deal with that? Was it a process? Were you mad at the universe? Did you wake up one day and just decide you were going to move on? I mean, that's got to be traumatic.
Yeah, I mean, it was a traumatic experience for me being in this accident. I think when you're 22, kind of believe that you're immortal and will last forever and can do whatever you want and nothing will stop you, and like I was on a path and that's what I was going to be forever, which is obviously not really what happens in life for most people. So it was hard and traumatic, but, and I was angry about it in a bunch of different ways, but you know, I try very hard to take bad things that happen to me and turn it into something good, and so I got very caught up in trying to change my experience into something, to turn it into something that could be useful for other people. So that really made it easier for me to move forward with a new life plan even at 22. Thank you so much.
Wine and Madeleine's, and Molly will be in the other room where her book is available for purchase and signing if you like.